27, 2015, committee of the whole meeting. We do have regrets from Councillor Lucien Leblanc. Number two, approval of agenda. Anybody care to move the approval of the agenda?
So moved.
So moved. Okay, no additions. Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. Conflict of interest declarations. Does anybody have a conflict of interest? Any of the other items on the agenda? Having heard none, we'll move on to three, which is presentations. We don't have any. Number four, business arising from the minutes. 4A, municipal administration building. We did get a report, an executive summary and a report in our email, and hopefully everybody got a chance to go over it and read it. We'll pass this on to CAO Muse. Go ahead.
Thank you. So with the information that we've collected over the course of months, we received information from engineers regarding the condition of the current building that's been attached in the appendix. And you had actually received that information prior to, so this is the second, that's the second time that had been distributed. I also distributed by email the larger report that was done in 2009, I believe is the year. That report is gives more detail, because the 2015 report is actually a revision of the original report. It's the 2015 does stand on its own, however, in terms of the information that is in there. It just, the 2009 gives a lot more detail around what they did when they did the assessment of the building. And at the time in that particular year, they had not contemplated the assembly building code section, which changes the numbers drastically. However, the deficiencies that they identified in 2009 were certainly correct, and when we had the opportunity to talk with them at that time. So the report, there's an executive summary and then there's detail. I trust that you've read through this. There's this report takes principally a financial look at the options. It talks about the three options that council is faced with now. Is one is to do nothing, and that is a legitimate option. All three are legitimate options, in fact. The second is to retrofit existing, and the third is to build new. So I don't want to go into great detail. I would prefer to hear from you around your reaction to the report. What I'd like, from a staff's perspective, what I'd like to understand is what additional information, if any, that you require as a council in order to further this issue or further this decision or make this decision. So if you feel like you read it and you felt like, man, I really need more information in order to make a decision, that's something I would like to hopefully hear from you today. What you'll see is the recommendation is actually not to proceed with the project. It's the recommendation is if you're going to pick one of the three options, is to endorse whatever recommendation you might come by and say, okay, now, assuming that it's not option three, because do nothing, you wouldn't go to the community and say, we're going to do nothing and we're going to engage you on that decision to do nothing. So clearly, if you're going to engage the community, it's on option two or three, which is to retrofit or build. So the other piece, so that's important to us. We need to understand what you need in order to make a decision and how you want to move forward based on this report, okay? Secondly, this is primarily financially driven. There are other factors at play in any decision. One of the things that I wanted to be very clear about, and I'm doing this really for television also, because they're, you know, the report isn't in front of somebody watching the TV necessarily, is that we took a life cycle cost assessment of the job. So assuming that it is a retrofit versus build, there's a cost associated to both. And we've said before that we think the cost, well, PDI Engineering estimates the cost of repair at a little over $2 million. That's quite speculative, because, you know, it could be 1.7, it could be 1.6, it could be 2.2. You know, you don't, you know, the problem with the retrofit is you don't know what you don't know, and you only find out when you get in.
Yeah.
So, but I think it's, if anything, I think that's probably on the higher side in terms of an estimate. But as you can recall, this, there is no option of a retrofit that doesn't involve expanding this building, because we will lose the use of the basement because it does not meet code. And so in the report, we describe this as it being very different than what we're used to as residents. So when we do, when we put an L in our building, we add another, you know, we add a deck or something on our residential home. The code doesn't force us to change everything to meet the code when you're doing that from your home. But because this is an assembly building, it's subjected to different rules. And so that's the reason why an expansion would be necessary in a retrofit situation. So there's no cheap alternative to a retrofit. We have to address all of those issues, unfortunately. So then, of course, then what we also had was that it's $263 a square foot to build new, and that's an all-in kind of situation. Contractors would tell you that that's high based on today's market, but I would prefer to be estimating high than estimating low. And so what the report also describes is the square footage we think we're going to need. And of course, in any consideration for a new building, you do have control over certain factors. You have control over its design, you have control over its size, you have control over its location. And so while you're always have unknowns in construction, there are certain things that you can decide to do or not do to keep the cost of that addition to that new building to a respectable level. And so we think that the cost of new is probably 2.1 to 2.3. And so while on the surface you would say, well, a retrofit's cheaper, it's actually not. Because if you look at the life cycle cost of the asset, if you think about when the old building has to be replaced, that's a lot less time than when the new building has to be replaced. And so while you're adding a new addition that has probably a 60-year life, your existing building does not. And so when you take a look at that and you take a look at, okay, when does the taxpayer have to reinvest in this building? And so that's the decision that you have to look at in terms of, okay, the lifespan of the asset, how does that look? And it's not close, actually, you know. Can the retrofit be done less expensive than $2 million? Probably. But in order for it to be close to new construction in terms of being, you know, comparable, it would have to be half of the cost. So that's really high level explanation of the report. As you know, you have the report in front of you, you've read it. What I've tried to address is, you know, here's the estimated square footage of a potential new building, here's what our existing square footage would be in the retrofit or in our existing situation, so there's a difference there. Where's the money coming from? Where, you know, what? How would we plan to pay for this? Is also in the report. If you build new, where do you build new? Right. So there's the location piece that we attempted to address in this report, and what do you do with the old building is also addressed in the report as well. And it's just identifying options that we have that we want to, you know, we try to be as comprehensive as possible so you could make the best decision possible. So. I realize this is a big report. I did it purposely in a report format. I didn't do it as a request for decision because, you know, it's a big project. The ramifications are large. And so I think it deserved a bit more detail to help you make that decision.
All right. Questions? Councillor Muse.
The size of the building, like, I read that it was determined that you would need that much space based on staff or based on a report. We had talked about getting someone to give that person the size of the staff and whatever, like what we needed, and they were going to come up with what they thought we needed for billing. Is that the way that
yes.
was done?
Yes, the information on chart A that shows the existing and required space,
yes.
that was prepared, well, it's this chart was prepared by John Sullivan. The information is coming from Robert Chipman.
Robert, yeah, okay.
Chipman?
Yeah, it was, I'm pretty sure, that's who, yes, a local architect.
So we asked him to do something very simple. We asked him to take a look at this building and interview everyone and say, you know, what's your current, you know, what's your current need and what do you need? And so it was very basic. And so based on that, that's the estimate for the size.
Okay, yeah.
That does include the EAOC, the EOC. It includes the Emergency Operations Center.
Yes.
So that may or may not be in a new building option, right? Because you could do that somewhere else, in theory.
And there's a bit of room for if we need more room, it's not just based on exactly what we have today. It's based on maybe having more staff, having more services, you know, that we would need more space as well, so that we wouldn't have to build. Or is the building designed that if we needed to do that, then we can easily add on if we had to?
I would suggest that at 8,200, you're squeezing now.
Right.
So if you took out, so if you look at the numbers, what you'll see is what was is the square footage that I use in the comparison is 8,500 to 9,000 square feet. So I do add a little bit more. But I think, you know, we don't have a design in mind right now that is hard and fast.
Okay.
But I think it would be smart for us, if we were to look at new, to consider something that is expandable. You don't have to build it today if you don't need it today.
That's right.
But you should build in a way that you might anticipate that and be able to add. The other thing that we want to do is use the space that we have as effectively as possible, like in this room, for example.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this room is used, you know, in comparison to the other rooms of this building, this particular room is used maybe 4 or 5% of the time.
Yes.
So what other purposes can you use this room for, right? Yeah. So it's also about multi-use of the space that you have, not necessarily overbuilding the space, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I'd say 8,200 is really on the low side. 8,500, you're starting to be okay. 9,000 is probably safer, which should be sufficient. And to give you a comparison, I did get this information from the town and municipality of Yarmouth. I'm waiting for Claire, which in fact is kind of a shame because Claire would be, you know, from a staff perspective, would be bigger than us, but not much bigger. So it would have been nice to get their square footage. I think their square footage is about 12,000 or 13,000. I'm guessing.
With the basement.
With the basement, right?
Yeah.
And the town of Yarmouth is 14,000. Now keep in mind, their public works, they only have 3 public works staff in that building, okay? So the whole public works of the town is in a separate building.
Yeah.
And the municipality of Yarmouth is 21,000 square feet. So that one was built for growth, clearly.
Yeah. Okay. No, there was a lot of good information in there. There definitely was, you know, it was well explained. And okay, thank you.
All
right. Councilor Donaldson.
Okay, maybe I'll give this one the political spin on this one. I do agree a new building is probably the best option. I don't agree with the timing, because no matter how much public consultation you try to engage the community in, you're generally gonna get the negative aspect. It's hard to bring that down. They're the ones who do all the talking. Anytime you show people change or ask them for change, you're going to have a lot of negativity. The ones that agree or neutral usually don't say too much to start with, and it's just going to give whoever's having elections, their opponents, firepower that you can't fight back against. And it gives your opponents, anybody running against you, a big advantage because they got nothing to lose. And they're just going to use it for all they can use it for. And that's just the way it is. When you try to have public consultation, you have very low turnout and generally naysayers. So that's where I stand on it. And just a point, I mean, I know we're not thinking about amalgamation, but having 3 brand new town office buildings within 15 minutes drive of each other, from the outside looking in, it does look kind of silly for less than 25,000 people. But that's a different argument altogether. There's my point of view. But I do agree with the new building, just not the time.
All right, anybody else care to weigh in? Don't see anybody else. Councilor Charette?
There's probably a few questions I would like, first of all, before I go into my main speech. I did some checking in the last few days, and I'd like to ask a CAO, and probably a challenge, if you know me, but I think it's a fair challenge. I checked with a couple of building inspectors, and just to find out on what a retrofit would involve and where the grandfathered comes in. And here's what I was told. So, okay, let's say that we went and did a wheelchair accessibility. That's all we did. Let's say we just decided we're not going to do anything else, just a wheelchair accessibility. I've read on page 5, it says, this means that to address our issue of accessibility, we'd have to address all issues. That's the first sentence on page 5, on that top line. Here's what I was told, and again, I'll be very honest, they said, this is where we stand. They never said, this is the code, they said, this is what we would do. And they said that if you're doing a wheelchair accessibility, they come and check, and they'll just check what you're doing there. This would not get to do a fire rating on the floor, to change your stairways, or do this and that on. If you were doing council chambers downstairs, so you want to put council chambers downstairs, they would go with the room that you are working on, and because this is a building, is grandfathered, they will not deal with anything else that's in the national code because we fit in. And this was their opinion. Mm-hmm. And I'd like to challenge you on that, where this came from. The two people I talked to are building inspectors. The only thing I don't know, if the building code is different in Argyle, is there, if it's a provincial code. Okay, I never went and asked them that. Okay, I'd like to challenge on that and to find out, to be sure, this, you know. So in other words, anything we'd be doing to change this building to their opinion. Now again, I did address changing chambers downstairs, doing something else, just address what you're doing. And I said, you're sure this is a public building? They said, yes, we're sure. A wheelchair ramp, the same thing. They wouldn't be looking to get the board entrances done and make them fire rating and that. This is what they told me.
I think so they didn't give you a code reference. So that's what I'd want to do is understand under what code reference that they would have given you that information. I think that if you were to do
that's fair.
And I can get that. I think the question is a valid question because the answer to that question drives the cost of this comparison very much.
That's why I'm bringing this up first.
Right. So we've already established that that it is we have practical issues with simply putting a ramp. We cannot just simply put a ramp and address the barrier-free issue. I think they're probably right when they say that if you just put a ramp, that you wouldn't have to do everything on the inside.
Yeah. You don't need a bathroom, a public bathroom, they told me. Told me you don't need to. Yes, but they said if you want to do it, it's up to you. The code would not drive a bathroom to be wheelchair accessible up there. They said you wouldn't need it.
Well, that may or may not be true. Okay. I'm not going to challenge what an inspector says because I'm not a code expert. I think the question begs another question is what section of the act is driving this decision? Let's go to the actual legislation and let's get people to interpret that.
Makes sense.
And so I'd be happy to do that for the council. But there's another question you have to ask yourself is whether or not if you could get away with that, do you want to not deal with your bathroom? Because once people get in, if they're in a wheelchair and you don't address those issues, then you actually don't have a barrier-free environment. You actually have a way for people to come in and pay their taxes potentially, and then leave.
Yes.
You know, there would be other factors of barrier-free outside of just
Would those be code-related, or just something that you, are you saying that barrier-free, I kind of don't...
Well, barrier-free is handicap accessibility. It's just another barrier-free, meaning there are no barriers for somebody...
Oh, I get you, sorry, I didn't...
To go into the bathroom, for example. So you could get people, you know, so I think, you know, what we've learned is, and we've tried to do this, is that the ramp is practically challenging. We'd have to start the ramp somewhere way back, you know, because of the code and how it has to be a certain... Right? So we have established that that's probably not going to solve our barrier-free issue, and that there is either a lift or an elevator that would be required in order to address it properly, but it's not the only thing. The other thing is that once they're in the building, there are certain rooms that somebody with a disability can't access, right? So, and the bathrooms being one of them. So you know, from a practical perspective, if you're going to renovate this building, you probably put that stuff in the extension,
yes.
Right? If you
yes.
have an extension,
right.
Which you're challenging because you're saying that if that's not true, you wouldn't use, you'd still have use for the basement, so you wouldn't have to extend it, right?
Yes, exactly.
So I can't give you assurance today that somebody's interpretation of the code compared to somebody else's interpretation of the code will give you the answer.
That's why I asked two people. I said two people, and they came with the same answer. But again, I'm, you know, you
right.
Could,
so they may or may not have considered the assembly building component of the code.
I told them it was this place, though.
Okay.
I did tell them it was this place. Yes.
Right.
No, because I read what you did here was very good. Because you know, it was very good the way you.
And I'm not hearing you. What I'm hearing you ask is what is the deal with this accessibility thing, and why do we have to do everything?
Yeah.
When we crack open this thing, why do we have to do it all? Yeah. It's a legitimate question.
Yeah.
So what I think I will do, because I can't give you an assurance of that tonight, is I can get back to you with here's the code, here's what it looks like, and then maybe you can take that information and go back to the inspectors that you've asked, because depending on how you've asked the question, they've given you an answer, right?
And that is fair.
So you know, like, trust me, we want to get to the bottom of that.
Oh, no.
That's our interpretation of that,
yeah.
And we want to know that for sure. So that's one I can come back with.
Could you? Okay. The next thing is again, and you know, I probably brought this up at council, that elevator. That's 331,000, I believe, or maybe I'm a little off. I should be, if I look at that pricing, let me look on the back here. Elevator.
331,500.
331, yeah, I had it marked down. Now, in all honesty, that is not needed. That is not needed. If you were doing a retrofit, the elevator is not needed. You are putting that in as a convenience. Am I maybe saying that wrong? It would be handier to have an elevator, but you don't need an elevator. You have people that can physically, because if you did a retrofit, so what I'm talking about retrofit, do you really need an elevator? Because there's nobody downstairs, and you could use that as potentially as a storage. So that 331, I don't feel is needed there. Which has jumped the price up.
So what I'm hearing you ask is because we're doing an extension.
Let's say we were retrofit
and no longer using the basement, there would be no requirement to go down to the basement.
No, there would be a requirement to bring your storage in that.
Right, but from a public accessibility
thank
perspective.
Thank you very much. You got into
what,
it.
What I'm hearing you say is there would no longer be that requirement. Yeah. There would still be a requirement, however, to provide a barrier-free access to this building. So if we could do that without an elevator, I would love to, because an elevator is an inconvenience. An elevator has an annual cost. It's an inconvenience, to be honest. If there's a way to do it without an elevator, that would be fantastic, from the perspective of extending. However, if we don't have the elevator, you can imagine, in order to allow for proper access, you're going to need to go further, right? You're going to need to go further because you're going to now have to do the ramp situation, right?
Because of barrier free?
Yeah.
So is that code? To have barrier free to the basement? Because wouldn't
it
be
no,
a
no, 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 not to the basement.
To this,
not
this,
to the basement.
This level here.
You still have to access this level as a resident. So if you're not going in the basement, right? If you're no longer using the basement.
Yeah, I follow you.
So in a retrofit option, if you can't use the basement, you must extend because you need the space.
Right.
So if you're going there, you're right, in theory, you would not require an elevator.
Because you could build that at ground level.
Well, you'd have to build it further.
Yes.
Because you'd have to have the ramp, the incline.
I know what you're saying now.
So while I think you might be able to eliminate the cost of elevator, it doesn't go to zero, right? There's another cost that comes up because actually increasing the square footage.
Very good.
Right?
Yeah,
so,
makes sense.
So, I mean, from my perspective, I think an elevator, I would prefer it be better access than an elevator. An elevator has it's expensive, right?
But we wouldn't need to go.
We wouldn't require an elevator if you would not require to go to the basement. What you require is access to this level for the public. So what you have to do is build all of your things that you build in the upstairs. You would have to build them barrier free.
No, I understand what you're saying. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think
you know, from my perspective, that was the point of looking at this, is because of the accessibility issue.
Yeah.
So we have to at least address that issue, I would suspect.
Yeah.
Your question on the code and not being able to use the basement is a very important one to get clear, however.
Yeah. Oh,
yeah.
Not even a question.
So okay. So I hear you on the elevator, and to be honest, I know it might be a little less expensive to extend.
I would think it'd be quite a bit less expensive.
Well, it's 263 a square foot.
Okay.
So depending on how many square feet you need
to get your ramp,
your incline.
Yeah.
Right? And how far you have to go in order to
get
to
that.
Need, yeah.
Yeah.
So it's probably cheaper than an elevator,
yeah.
I would suspect.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, I just have a few more things if you don't mind. I want to thank you, Mr. Chair, for giving me a chance here to talk about the building. I have a question: is do we need a building? Is the building really required? We have less people staying in our municipality. We have a lot of seniors, of course. I guess when I look at the great opportunities the municipality has for the residents, I am also reminded that we only have one taxpayer. And to go spend a lot of money into a new building is putting a lot of pressure on that same taxpayer who's had a lot of pressure in the last 8 years. So I guess my question is, do we really need a new building? Can we not work on what we've got and have a look at maybe putting a moratorium for 3 years on this? Moratorium for 2 years, 5 years? And look at where we're going. Are we going, which was a good word, I enjoyed that word, regionalization. Will we be, you know, will there be something coming up down the road that we may regionalize it? The three units maybe working together as one unit. Like Councillor Donaldson said, there's already two new buildings in the area. Do we really need a new building? Yes, we do have money put aside. It doesn't mean that we need to spend it right away. Maybe we should be looking at, you know, maybe doing the wheelchair accessibility here for the time being, because it doesn't, if what they told me, like the CAO said, he'd have to check into that. Does it really involve changing codes? Do we really have to go do a lot of work? My idea is, I see a lot of people, I hear them talk, and they're having a hard time to pay their farmer care bills. They're having a hard time, some of them, to go and if they have to go to town. A lot of them tell me they make one trip a week instead of making the two or three trips. They're having a hard time to pay their bills. And here we are, you know, looking at a new building. If I was sitting on the side of staff, you know, it's not a pleasant to be downstairs. I've been down there a few times, but I don't work there. I know it's not pleasant, but when you have to turn around and look and see what the ratepayers, the taxpayers of our municipality are looking at, paying every month, every year, what it costs. You know, should we not wait? That's, to myself, maybe that's what we should be looking at. Do we really need a building? I would think that looking at the properties on the Viewpoint website and seeing what a lot of the properties have sold for in the last couple of years, I have looked at a lot of the properties that are selling way below assessment. So I feel that, you know, what's going to happen down the road? Less taxes coming in. Should we really go and borrow money for a new building or a retrofit? You know, I'm not sure if I agree with that. When I look at the cost of this building, and which was brought up by Mr. Muse about the size and that, and maybe it's 9,000 square feet we need instead of the 8,200 to look further ahead, which, hey, you have to look further ahead. I feel that this building, by the time we're done, is 3 to 4 million. My rationale behind that is, if we have to tear down this building here, buy a lot, extra for this, extra for that, paving, blah, 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 when we look down the road, I think this building is looking at, instead of 2 million, I can see 3 million without a question from reading the report. I tell you what, this is a great report. I will say that the two people I checked with the building inspectors, they've read the report, and they said this was a really good report, and I'll give credit where it's due. It's well done. But at the same time, when I look into everything like everybody else has, I see 3 million. I do see 3 million here. Not a question. I could expand on that, but, you know, I won't. My idea myself is to leave it as it is. Let's put a moratorium on 3 years and come back and look and, you know, what's happening. What's happening in our municipality, what's happening in our area, and sit back down and look at it. This report will still be here. The money will still be in the bank. And you know, do we go to prioritize different places? Well, you know, one place we could go is go and get the exception to seniors. Instead of 14, 15, 16,000, maybe bump their exemption to 20,000, 21,000. I've seen in some of the other municipalities, that's what they've done. We could always put that money towards, because we do have an aging population. But I would say, let's look. Do we really need a building? Can't we work out of this? This is a fine building. It's still good for quite a while. Why don't we look at staying here for a bit and let's sit on what we've got, watch our expenses. We still can come and decide in a year, 2 years, 3 years. Okay, let's bring it to the public. That's my 10 cents worth. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Donaldson.
Yeah, there was a couple things Gabe brought up and got me thinking about. If you decided to stay here and we was just after handicap accessibility, I was thinking, has it ever been looked at going downgrade, taking some of the front of the parking lots, expanding the parking lot back on land we have, but going down, making a lobby area in the basement. That way you're on the same level as your bathrooms. You can retrofit your bathrooms if you need to. Elevator to this level, basically what it looks like in Yarmouth on their basement level when you go in the back way. There's an elevator to bring you upstairs. But I mean, you're the grade's halfway between the two levels now. So what you'd be looking at is taking some of the parking lot and making a, you know, can anybody visualize what I'm talking about?
Oh, no, exactly.
You're talking about making the grade like a little bit like this.
So going down.
Going down so that
you make doorway access the basement and have a lobby area in the basement with an elevator that brings you to this level. But the bathroom issue is taken care of because the bathrooms are downstairs and that's where the level you'd be entering on. And if the other thing he brought up, if you decided to expand this building, make it ground level, make your essential services on the ground level that the public would need, this could be used for for offices that aren't going to be visited by the public, that most of them that are already downstairs could come up and use, occupy this part of the building. I mean, those are things that weren't looked at, I don't believe. But if you're not expanding, there's, I'm just thinking if you're going to do an elevator versus a ramp, because around, you said a ramp would be a long winding thing, you'd start in North Belleville to get it to come. But,
Middle.
Yeah. But anyhow, I was just thinking going down, excavating down and making your entrance down there. And I mean, you're going to, it's going to be fairly costly, but I think that if you're going to do elevator, that would be the best way to do it.
Well, I mean, I think to answer your question, I think there's a lot of ways to do these kinds of things, and they all cost differing levels of money. Mm-hmm. And so, challenges we definitely have for a ramp is the fact that we would have to utilize the current parking to do it, right? So, again, I mean, you know, if you're willing to scrap your parking and go out further,
But don't we own a fair bit of land that
could? We own the adjacent property. We have land over into the other property. We're not just restricted to what you see here. I believe it's a little over 2 acres. I can't remember exactly how large, but certainly large enough to build.
But if council does decide to set on this for a while, we definitely have to address the handicap issue no matter what we do. I think that's going to be done.
I'm surprised
we've been allowed to get away with it this long, or somebody hasn't complained, or
we've received complaints.
Okay, I'm surprised senior levels of government haven't got on our case then.
Yeah, I think that they probably, my guess would be, and this isn't a political statement, this is a practical statement, my guess is that that's probably not a file that they're looking at right now. I think they're probably, you know, they did look at the MLA offices to make sure they were barrier-free and passed legislation to do that. I guess in theory they could do that with us, but I imagine they're not going to do that anytime soon, because then you're really forcing a cost on the municipalities, and that's been a taboo kind of topic for relationships problems.
Okay, I'm not going to turn my mic off, so.
Okay. All right. I have a question for CA Musa. I guess, Councillor Surrett, you mentioned about maybe having to buy land. We have how many lots at our disposal?
We have three lots principally. I mean, one of them I think would be kind of a dream, which is in between the courthouse and the archives. I mean, you'd have to, there's like no space there.
Yeah.
I mean, it would have to go up. Yeah, right. But yeah. I mean, it would be a visual masterpiece. I guess that's a dream. But it is a property we own. And the other property, of course, is this existing property. It does go beyond. Also the business park, right? So the business park, we own multiple properties. And so, you know, while we've sold some on the outside, none of the inside are being used. Two have been sold, but they're not being used. They could probably be repurchased by the municipality, but you could in theory use other lots in that middle, I call it the island, which the Slocum Crescent goes around. I mean, you know, the cheapest place to build in terms of like land use is where you are, right? Because you have the connection to the sewer, and you probably in every instance you have some groundwork to do. I can't assure you of that because, you know, you don't, you know, when you go into to territory that hasn't been clear, you know how marshy is it, how wet is it, so do you have to bring in something? So those are variables, but I think, you know, all in all, when taking all the variables into account, this is probably the cheapest location. It does have a benefit because people know we're here.
Yeah,
that's the other. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Councillor Muse.
When you're talking about location as well, I think that's very important to make sure that we're in a location that's more visible, as visible as we can. You know, I mean, change is one thing, new building and whatever, but I think to change a location might be even a worse sell. That's some of the comments that I've heard as well, like, you know, don't go in the park. Like, you're not, you're, you're, you're changing too much. Like, you know, if you're going to do anything, stay as close to where your actual location is, so that it doesn't. People are going to get more upset by the change if you change the location as well. And again, these are comments that I hear as well. But I've heard some positive, and I've heard some negative about a building, for sure. You know, I mean, you're not gonna please everybody. There's no doubt. But I don't know. I think being accessible, having a barrier free, is very important to me. It is important. I mean, I'm really surprised that we haven't been forced to do that at this point, because that's a lot of complaints and that's a lot of comments that I get, for sure. You know, we have a building, public building, that we can't even go in ourselves. And yeah. So anyway, that's just a comment.
Okay. Warden D'Antonio.
I'm ashamed to tell people that we're not wheelchair accessible. It drives me when people ask me, and I say, no, we're not. You know, this is crazy, this day and age. That's one point, you know. I don't know where Councillor Surratt gets his $3 million. I think because he wants to wait 3 years, it'll be $3 or $4 or $5 million. If you wait long enough, the price will be up a lot, you know. And the more we wait, then the higher it's going to get if we do it. But I don't go around looking for remarks, but what I hear is, oh, I hear you're thinking about doing something. I think you're crazy if you spend money on the old building. The way to go is a new building. That's what I hear. I don't hear a lot about it either, you know. Not trying to say that I hear that every day. I hear some comments off and on. Anyway, I would suggest my idea is to go with a new building, regardless what we do with this one, whether we use it for storage or tear it down or whatever. That would be my idea, for what it's worth.
Okay. All right. Now, I have a question for, I'll ask a question first for Councillor Muse. So you say you've had people about the location who have said, hey, this is your district, right? And these are mm-hmm. your people that live here, who are used to, you know, the municipal office being here. I can't speak for all my residents, but I know, you know, if we were to drive down the highway and turn and go, for example, and I'm just using this as an example, to our park, I don't think the people from my district would it would matter to them if they paid their taxes there or they paid their taxes here. But for you, the people in your area who, you know, grew up with the office here, I mean, this is the location, and I'm sure some people would probably be, you know.
If I can go answer ahead. That, it's not just people from my district either that are telling me this.
I've heard
people from other districts the same thing. And one location that's brought up a lot is by the courthouse. Mm-hmm. In between. Build a nice building between the courthouse and the archives, mm-hmm. you know.
So where
or by the property, the little house that's right over here. Right, and use that built there, and then you'll have parking. And the only thing is, you would need a two-story building.
No choice.
Absolutely.
No absolutely. Choice.
There's you'd no way
go,
that you
would have to go.
You'd
up.
Have to go up. Yeah. Definitely.
Where would the farmer's market go?
Yeah, where the farmer's market is. Exactly.
No, where would it go?
Oh,
where would the farmer's
go?
Market go?
But that's been brought up by more than one person, that would be the ideal. It would look so nice to have a building and make it look kind of like the courthouse and the archives, you know, as much as you can to blend in. But again, I mean, you've got to look where it's more advantageous or better to build. You can't just build it there because it's going to look good, for sure.
All right.
Anyway, yeah.
Councilor Albright.
Just thinking about, we talked a lot about the whole barrier-free, and we've talked about the public, but what would happen if a staff member was in a wheelchair? Like, we haven't really talked about that. Like, right now, if you hired somebody in a wheelchair, there's no way that they could get into this building, right? But when we're thinking about all the options, we've talked public, so put everything on one level. But what if you hired somebody who needed, you know, every part of it wheelchair accessible? So I'm just kind of thinking, like we've mentioned, we'll just make one level. But what if somebody, you couldn't not hire them because they're in a wheelchair and they can't get down to the basement?
Well, it's actually against the law.
Yes. So, like, I don't know. I don't know if we can think of just one level. That's kind of what I'm thinking. Do you know what I mean?
Well, one level. We retrofit.
Right. If, yeah. Let's say if we did the retrofit. Yeah. I don't think we could just do one level. I think it would have to be accessible at every level, because not just for public, but if you hired a staff. Like, when I hurt my knee, I couldn't come to the meeting because, I mean, whether there had been a ramp or not, I still couldn't have come to the meeting, even if we had a ramp, because I just could not walk. I would have needed, you know, to get in the building, and I would have needed an elevator, is what I would have needed, right? A ramp wouldn't have been enough in that circumstance. So I think we really need to think about all the, it's not just the public, because you may hire somebody who is in a wheelchair.
I mean, statistics are showing that it's not just, you know, our population is aging, and so you're going to have more mobility issues in that particular circumstance. But it's not just the aging population. It's also, you know, it's other things as well. You know, in an ideal world, this building would be all on one level, right?
Right.
But it's not, right? And so we're trying to deal with the situation. You know, we do have other challenges with this building that we're not talking about. Necessarily, not because we're trying to hide something. It's just that I think we're trying to stick to the issues that relate mostly to the public, because this is a public building. Functionally, this building works poorly for us. You know, having staff in the basement is not the greatest situation.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm not saying that, you know, just because it's a little inconvenient, we got to drop a couple of million in a new building. That's really, I'm actually quite frugal, you know that.
Mm-hmm.
I think, you know, the issue around access is going to be a growing problem. In fact, we had a staff person who became disabled, started here and was okay, but you know, was diagnosed with a degenerative condition. And we had to make do. We had a situation where somebody collapsed in the basement, and I was never more embarrassed in my life to have that person, the dignity that was lost by having that person having to try to get around a corner to get up and down the stair,
mm-hmm.
To get out of the building.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's a certain level of dignity here that I think we need to be thinking about. I recognize that it is a difficult political decision, and that's I'm hoping to stay away from that discussion, because that's for you to decide as politicians. What I'm trying to deliver is the message, the fiscal message, the financial message, and the financial message that I would like to deliver today. And I still stand by it, although I will check on some of the questions that Councillor Surrett has raised. I still stand by the build new is a better fiscal decision for the organization than retrofit.
Mm-hmm.
If you choose to do a moratorium, obviously that's the cheapest option, right? But you still have to address the issue. And so, I won't talk about the political aspect of that, because that might be more political than anything, but from the perspective of doing something that establishes a barrier-free situation, and that functions in a way that it should function, the new building option is the one being recommended. So it isn't just fiscal, it's functional. And by that I mean not just access by the public, but also how we deliver our services, right? So I think I cite an example where the recreation department may look to hire somebody, right? We're all concerned about cost, right? So they don't have anybody you know, they don't have anybody. When they're out, that's it. There's no service being delivered by recreation on site. If that, if the function was different, if the layout was different, Alyssa could deliver a reception service, could deliver a service, or somebody else could deliver a service that is now not being delivered, right? So we're forced to consider and typically deny, actually, the request for additional staff because we think that, you know, it might be short-sighted to hire staff to fill in that position when the function might change, right? The function of the building might change in both a retrofit or new, by the way. A retrofit, you can try to do things differently in a retrofit also to try to deal with function, right? Everybody's afraid of the Taj Mahal.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Everybody's afraid of the Taj Mahal.
Oh yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean,
well, I'm here.
Community is afraid of it. Counselors are afraid of it. Right. You know, like $3 million to build a 9,000 square foot building. That's $333 a square foot. I don't know what building can be constructed that expensively, but I'm sure it could be done. We have no intentions of building a building that expensive per square foot. That's not the market price right now. Right. So I think you do have. Like there's a lot of talk about regionalization, shared service, and how does that impact the delivery of service here? You know, look, you know, the service that we deliver to our region. We deliver it here in Tuscan, right? If it's not here, it's somewhere else, right? If it's not here, it's somewhere else. Argyle doesn't miraculously disappear because we're not offering services in Argyle. So if we're not offering them here in terms of tax collections or recreation, where are we offering them? Yarmouth. So we're asking our residents to travel more to Yarmouth and et cetera to be delivered a service or to deliver services. So we have to ask ourselves, in every regionalization, in every amalgamation, typically what has happened is there hasn't been a major decrease in staff. Not a major decrease. There has been some. But you have to ask yourselves, in an amalgamation, if you think that amalgamation is in your future, how much service will be delivered in your region? Right? It might be different, but will it be zero? Unlikely, right? But that's your call, right? It could be zero at your decision, right? It could be zero. So I guess what we have to take a look at is what does the service look like and what are the alternatives to what that service looks like in the future? And so how does that influence your decision to build or not build? I think that's something that you should be thinking about. And if you have to take your time to make that piece of decision, I think that's smart. You know, we're not asking you to rush into this decision. Like, you didn't see that anywhere in this report. You know, we expected you to have these concerns, right? So we will bring that information to you in waves as long as you want to do that. But we have to eventually deal with this, right? There's no avoiding the issue of accessibility. There might be an alternate solution that you haven't seen. Mm-hmm. There's always something, there's always a different way to do it, right? You know, what does that look like in terms of cost? We can go deeper into that. We can analyze that deeper. But what I think you also need to understand as council is it has to be half. Whatever it is, it has to be half the cost of a new building for it to make sense financially. Mm-hmm. That's the key, right? Not everybody, you know, grabs numbers and loves them, right? Like, not like me. But I think that's the key, right? If you're doing a retrofit, remember that the lifespan of the building is less than in a new. The efficiency of the building is less than in a new. There are costs associated with continuing to be in a retrofitted versus a new. The construction's completely different, and the efficiencies are different. So those are the things that you have to think about when you're making the decision. And so if we can cut the retrofit down to half of what we think a new construction is, that's a par, right? Now you're talking, right? Because then now you're actually comparing apples and apples and you might be able to come close, right? But that based on the numbers that we've looked at now, will be challenging. You know, and so I tried to stay with the financial side of things, right? Okay. And that's it.
Okay.
Coming back to Councillor Albright's comments about staff, we had a counselor here that couldn't get up the steps. I had to give up, you know. Too much problem getting in and out of the building. He was on council. Yeah.
Council Hughes.
Okay, Council Surratt.
I guess to maybe to allude a little bit to the CAO's comments on delivering services. Let's say there was amalgamation like Windsor and West Hants are looking at now there. You know, they've had the public, they've gone to the public and they've have a petition out and they've got 2,200 signatures and, you know, which is going to force the question. It'll come to a question if they do want to amalgamate or not. I think down the road, we could be seeing this. I'm not saying we are. I'm not fear-mongering. I'm just saying we could be seeing that seems to be the trend that's going. My question could be to everybody is, do you deliver the services that we have in Argyle, we will have? And I know everybody here and all the ratepayers would rather pay their taxes in Tuscan than go to Yarmouth if we did amalgamate. But do you pay your taxes in a $3 million building, or do you pay your taxes in a building that's like it is here now? You know, there's a huge difference there. So, you know, to answer that question, I say, hey, if we stick with what we've got, then you don't go to that big building that's $3 million and that you've got that won't be used as much. Because with amalgamation, if that was coming, and I'm not saying it's coming, you wouldn't have that building to deal with. You still have what you've got here. I'll say this. It would be nice. It was on our priority list. That's why it's here. I think it's a great discussion we're having. This is where it's going to be at. Also, I think that before I could make a decision, I certainly want to hear the public. That's one key element in my decision making. I'd have to hear it from the public, see what they've got. I have spoken, as Councillor Mew said, I've heard from other people from the Pubnico area, from the Westport area, and maybe I'm a little too bold. I have asked the question, what do you think about a building? And I'm telling you one thing. The big question, which I've tried to calm them down, the Taj Mahal in Yarmouth, that's all I'm, in the municipality, that's all I'm hearing. From Pubnico, I had a guy that came into the garage and said, you know what, I'm hearing. And are you guys going crazy? What are you doing? Again, that's only one person though. That's not everybody. But I have heard, but if you don't ask the question, how will you know? And I have asked the question around, not only in my own area. I still think, let's stick to what we've got. What we've got is paid for. And, you know, I don't see at the moment that we should move ahead. But again, to go one step further, I certainly would like to hear from the public, what the public has to say. And our approach of going to the public is in this report. Great. That's I'm all for it.
Thank you, Councillor Surratt. And as the chair of the committee of the whole, Councillor Surratt, I'd like to add that you've mentioned $3 million. That's your own number. Yes. That's not the number that was presented here tonight, was it?
The number that's presented here tonight is not totally accurate, in my opinion. The $2 million number, do we need the
okay, so is the $3 million accurate in your opinion?
In my opinion, and I tell you where my $3 million comes from, because it's been already said that the 8,200 is not big enough. I see this building, instead of 8,200, is going to end up 9,000, in my opinion. I also see that if we have to demolish this building here, that, you know, there's numbers that are not put in here. Let me finish. I'm not done. If we do a retrofit, the staff has to go somewhere else. So there's numbers there. I see $3 million. That's what I base my numbers on the extras that are in this report that haven't not been added to the $2 million for the.
I think that there's a number for the demolishing of this building for 30,000. Is that correct?
Yeah, we estimate that it'll
okay.
be about
so 30, there is a number for that.
That's you choose to.
But that's not added into the total of the bill if it was a retrofit. A new building.
But let me just clear the numbers. Let me just clear the numbers. If you what you say is true,
yeah,
that we go to 9,000 square feet in a new building,
yeah,
the best number we have, yeah, is the engineered number of per square foot, yeah, 263, right? I take 9,000, I multiply that by 263,
yes,
that's 2.367 million. If I add 30,000 to that number, that brings me at essentially 2.4.
And if the staff have to be moved?
But if you're building new.
Oh, brand new.
If you're building new, they're here and there's no cost, right? And you may or may not be able to sell this building if you build new, right? So there's an offset there that could potentially be, I'm assuming, the worst case scenario, which would be a demolition. But the other scenario might be that you sell this for 100 grand or whatever, right? And so that we don't know.
That's a good point.
But I assume the worst case because I want to try to paint an accurate picture. I hear what you're saying around the fear that it's not going to be 267, that it's actually going to be a larger number. But I think 3 million is way out.
Well,
here's the bottom line. Like, we wouldn't do it if it was 3 million. Like, we would, you know, we have full control over the design and the size.
Yeah.
If it comes back and they say, look, it's 333 square foot, you're at 9,000 square feet, and this is how much it costs, like, guess what? We're not doing that. Like, we can't do that.
Yeah.
I think it's a legitimate fear of everyone that sees a new building and says, you know, how many stories do you see in the media where they say it's going to be this and it's that, right? And that's a legitimate fear, right? But you know, we're not talking about exquisite design. We're talking about basic design, wood construction, something can be done locally, and that could be, that actually would be influenced, and my hope would be, in an ideal world, if you choose a new, that it would be influenced by some of the people that do work, right? Because they know how to do these things efficiently. They know how to build efficiently. We don't want to bring in you know, architects and engineers from Halifax so that it can be like this thick, and no offense to Halifax, I'm just making a point that you can over design a building or you can make it simple. And so we don't need it to be, this has to be simple, right? You know, the credit union has constructed two new buildings in the municipality, right? Recently, right? You know, like they're basing decisions on the economy also. You know, we have to consider that. You know, they might be a good idea for us as staff and council to talk to the credit union management. You know, how did you come to that decision? Why did you come to that decision? What was it? So, you know, why is it that they came to that decision? And other people, you know what? Other people have made a decision to retrofit. You know, it might be interesting to get their input on that too, right? Like, you know, we're happy to do that.
Yeah.
But you know, like, and I hear you on the concern.
Yeah.
I don't think we have to rush, but I think we have to do something eventually, because you go back, it's 1998 when we first started talking about this. It's been a while. You know, like, if we're not going to do something with this building, then that's
stop
okay.
Talking about it.
Yeah, we'll take it off the list.
Yeah.
And I'm not trying to be a jerk about it. Like, we'll take it off the list and we'll do something else. Like,
we're on the same page.
And we'll do what we can to make sure this thing doesn't collapse, right? Like, and I'm not trying to be a jerk about that either.
Yeah.
I just, this building was built in, you know, it wasn't built yesterday. So you know, we would have some structural things that we would have to do from a safety.
But you do have reports that says it's a building, as we've seen them.
Yeah.
The building is still there.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
Councilor Dawson.
Yeah, just to clarify something that Alan and Guy both brought up about coming for municipal services to Tuscan, whatever. I would like to point out, people in Argyle and Pumlico, if they're coming this far, generally they're going to Yarmouth anyhow. And Wedgeport, Plymouth, down Junior's Way, generally they'd probably rather go to Yarmouth anyhow for services. So, I mean, that isn't, to me, that isn't a legitimate argument one way or another. Like, it works both ways. And there was something else, too. So tonight, we got to decide. I mean, we've been going on here well over an hour. But we got to decide something tonight, whether we're going to make this an election issue, or we're going to set it, like you said, a moratorium for X number of months, years, whatever. But that's got to be decided, because this has come up several times, and we've got some decent numbers now. But like you said, we need a lot of public input. Or do you want it to be part of an election campaign? That's the question you have to ask yourself tonight. Personally, I don't, but that's one out of nine. So how do we come to that conclusion tonight? That's what we got to decide, because you need answers to whether to start setting up meetings in community halls and getting a few more figures for one Guy's questions and, but, so, I mean, we can just keep doing this for another 11 months and we'll get by, but.
Well, we are not, I just want to be very, very clear from an administrative perspective. A question was asked today around the National Building Code that would have significant implications to the cost. So if we establish that the assembly building regulations, for whatever reason, are incorrectly
interpreted.
Attached or interpreted in
yep.
this case, that changes the figures a little bit, right? So I think that if the numbers change significantly, you know, you probably want to know that for sure, right?
Yes, for that.
I can certainly get that information fairly quickly, possibly by the next meeting. I would think that I'd be able to establish one way or another whether or not we're interpreting that properly from an inspection perspective. I think that has important implications. It may or may not influence your decision. It may or may not influence your decision because you may actually think, you know what, we don't want people in the basement. We don't care what the building code forces us to do. We're going to do what we want to do, right? So that could be your decision as council. But I'd like for you to know the difference, right? So I can bring that back to the next meeting, Councilor Donaldson. I think that that's probably fair. You know, the other, you know, so again, our recommendation wasn't to make a decision whether you're going to go ahead and build new or retrofit today. Our decision, our recommendation was to, or stay the same. Our recommendation was that you first have this discussion and eventually come to a conclusion as to where you're going, and including the timing. That's, we don't have to move tomorrow on this, right? But we can't stop. And if that's a decision of council, then what I would recommend is that we actually take it off the list of priorities and find another way to deal with this.
Just one more question. Can I go?
Go ahead.
When it comes to cost, like I'm leaning new building. I'll admit that right now. But if we go in and use our reserves, like it's pointed out here, and then low interest borrowing, for politicians, tax rates are important, like mm-hmm. what's going on. Like that wasn't addressed. Like that's going to be part of the discussion too, on what the extra borrowing is going to cost the taxpayer.
Yeah. Well, I can answer that question financially. So what we've done is for the past X amount of years, I'm going to say 15.
No, 24. Since I've been here, we've been putting money away for a building for as long as I can remember.
Well, it's at least 15, not 24. So there might have been small dollars at one point, yeah. But it started to get real serious about 15 years ago,
yeah.
And we started putting about 100,000. Now, I
yeah.
still can't find that motion, by the way, but there was a decision to put 100,000 away for 10 years,
yeah.
Right? And to get to a million, right? That was... Based on the evidence, that's what was decided, but I can't find the motion, which is very, very strange.
So is that for a building, if you don't mind me just asking?
That was for retrofit or new. That
okay,
was for
so
this.
That money was
and that goes back.
I didn't know.
Yeah.
That goes back when Robert Tebow was
that's
here.
Right.
We was talking
okay,
about
okay.
that.
Yeah.
And that's been, he's been
99.
Gone 14 years.
Yeah.
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 It was in 99.
16 years.
Yeah.
15,
okay.
16 years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, you know, you could pay for the building. Like if the building was 2.2 million, you have the money in the capital reserves, you could pay 100% not borrow a darned dime, right?
Yeah.
The reason why I recommended that if you're going to do that, that you do a combination, is because you can borrow short term at a lower interest than what your money is actually making in the bank. So it's actually cheaper not to use the money in the capital reserve, right?
Oh
which is which kind of blows your mind a little, but. It's true.
Yeah.
Now that might change, right? The environment now is that. So that's. Yeah.
What would it do to the tax rate? Yeah, that's the question.
All right, I'm getting there. So we're putting away a hundred and something thousand a year, which is included in your tax rate today.
Yes.
There's
yeah.
no way the cost of borrowing will be that much. So effectively, there should be zero impact to the tax rate based on the new building.
See, that's an argument we need. Facing the public on
much.
everyday
big
life.
Big time.
We can build the building, it's not gonna cost you 1 cent more, we've been saving for years and years.
They've already paid.
Yeah.
They've already paid.
Right.
It's not built.
Cheaper to operate.
Yeah.
More efficient.
Yeah, no, the short answer is you've already paid, Mr. and Mrs. Resner.
Yeah.
That's really the short answer. I should've started with that.
Yeah.
You know how to waste an hour, then.
I do.
You could've started that.
I've become professional at it, right? Thank you.
By the way, this is not wasting an hour, this is a good discussion.
No, it's not.
To me, this is really good, believe me.
All right, so that, your question, okay?
Yeah, like, I'm way clear enough.
Okay, Counselor Muse again.
Talked on the phone, but I mean, I didn't cover all of it over here.
Yeah, okay. Counselor Muse.
My question that I had was just answered.
Okay.
I had a couple of questions and.
Okay, so we've had, there's no more lights on here. Anything else to add, CEO Muse?
Just our commitment.
Okay.
Right? Just our commitment to
go
come
ahead.
Back.
One point I wanted to make, I think maybe Richard kind of said it too. Councillor Surratt, you mentioned lost my train of thought now, but something. I had it there.
Don't worry.
Oh, no. Going to the public.
Yes.
You know, this is what we're kind of trying to establish. You know, this is the first decision we have to make. Do we want to go to the public? You know, really. We're going to the public. Definitely. But we haven't decided yet.
Oh.
Because we haven't decided to build yet.
Right.
Or decided
not,
you know,
to build
or whatever.
Yeah.
So, you know, there's nothing going to be done before you go to the public.
Yeah.
You know, that's for sure. No hard decisions. Yeah. Anyway.
Okay. So I think through all the discussion, if I remember correctly, it's been a long one. We've come up with we have a few questions that Councilor Surratt asked CEO Muse about the code.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess we probably want an answer to that before we move on, or?
Yes, I would say.
I think it's a valid and very important question, and we need to know that.
It may or may not influence ultimately your decision.
That's right, but,
okay.
Yeah.
Right, because you have to think about why you're building the new building, right?
Yeah.
This is at the expense of being political. Sorry, Mr. Chair.
Yeah, go ahead.
My apologies. So at the risk of being political, you have to understand the why on this building. Yeah. Nobody ever questions why on a new school. Nobody ever questions why on an L in a hospital, because they understand the services that are being delivered when you build those kinds of buildings. The challenge we have is the challenge every municipality has, right? What is it that we need to spend money on a building for staff, right?
Yeah.
Well, staff deliver your services. Right? No different than in a school, no different than in any other facility that is publicly funded. You know, our staff is not bringing this to your attention because we want a brand spanking shiny new building. We're bringing this to your attention because we deal with the complaints. Now,
yeah.
We don't get them every day, but we get them. And we know this building is tired. It needs something, right? What that is a political decision, right? Our role is to try to bring you this information in the best way possible. I certainly don't want to walk into a Taj Mahal and work in a Taj Mahal. I'd be embarrassed, quite frankly. You know, we are used to doing things our way, right? Which is, you know, small ball, right? I don't know if that's an expression that everybody uses, but it's frugal, it's not out of the ordinary, and so regardless of what we decide to do, that's how it's going to look. From the analysis, we think new offers the best deal to the residents if you're going to do something. So we'll look at that information, certainly, and obviously, you know, in terms of like public engagement, I don't know whether you have comments on that as to whether as to how we're going to do that. That can be discussed at the next meeting or now. You know, how do we bring this information to the public in an effective way? Is a discussion for now or the next meeting. That's up to you, Mr. Chair.
Yeah, well, I don't know if people have had enough of the subject for now and want to kind of digest, or do you want to continue on and talk about public consultation? I guess, Councilor Surratt.
I, as you know me, I wouldn't mind talking about public consultation. I believe that, you know, when you start from East Pubnico right to Camo's Hill, I guess the community hall meetings, I would, in my way of thinking, go to each district, at least have, it might be cumbersome, I don't know if that's the right word, to go to 8 meetings, have one main meeting, but I would prefer if we went to each district and had a meeting. If we end up with 2 people at one meeting and 35 at another, so be it, but each district. I know it would be a lot of work for staff, but by God, we couldn't go after and say at least we didn't give everybody a chance. I know when we did for the amount of counselors, you know, that to me was as fair as you can have anything. Although we didn't go in every district, everybody had a chance. I sent out 50 emails. I had one person that came, and I had people that came, well, look what you did. You didn't put the counselors down. And I pointed them and I say, I sent you an email. Where were you? And they don't say a word. That's why I voted to stay the same, because the chances were given. And this way, if we brought to each district, by God, if they want to yak and yap, you have the chance. If they don't want to, then I'll vote with what I hear at the meetings. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else care to weigh in? Go ahead.
I don't think we would need to go to every district, because in our case, West Pubnico has 2 districts. I don't think we need 2 meetings in West Pubnico, even east west, you know,
that's fair.
But like you said, like we had what, 3 meetings for the other one, for the number of councillors, something like that, but not 9 meetings.
Not.
I don't think I wouldn't.
Very interesting what you have to say. Okay.
Each end in the center.
To work with.
Okay.
All right. So if we do go to the public, but I guess we have to then make a decision on what we're doing first. Really.
Yeah, I think it's important for staff to understand how you want to deliver this information. Like you know, we've offered a number of ways we can do that. We can do online surveys. We can do a little video. We're not doing gumballs. But we can do a little video, a little 2-minute, here's A, here's B, here's, you know, here are your options, you know, and what do you think? And it's like, it's one question, right? Which one do you think is best for you? You know, having the information in front of them, and then they click and send, right? That you could do that very quickly, get some pretty quick feedback. That would be, I think, a bit more inclusive, because not everybody has the opportunity to go to community meetings, right? So I think you want to do a little bit of both. Hopefully by next meeting we'll have enough information around the code question that enables council to make a decision. Look, you can table this decision. It's an option. It's there, right? And so that's up to you around timing. But what I'd really like to be in the position to do is if you when you're ready to do something, right, decide what you'd like to do. That's really where staff would like to go, because we require that direction. So anyway, so I think I've probably beaten that dead horse.
I don't know if there's such a thing as a right time. How many years I've been talking about this, and we keep putting it off. I don't know, you know, when is the right time? As far as I'm concerned, the right time is now. You know, keep putting it off. When's going to be the right time? If you wait for the right time, I don't know if they'll ever come.
Yeah. You know. Councillor Mews?
Me again. What would be your timeline? What do you think is a good time to go to the public? Like, do we want to have something done in the next year, in the next 2 years? When you're saying, you know, if we were to make a decision now, let's say, do you think we should go to the public next month or is...
If you were to make a decision now to say, look, we want to build new,
Yeah.
Right? We think this is the best decision, and we want to go to the public to confirm our decision,
mm-hmm.
right? You could do that, you know, in the next, I'd say 30 to, you know, 120 days, like,
okay.
or even more. Like,
yes.
you can take your time on that process. We're not doing any construction next
no.
summer. Not going to happen.
No.
Not ready. We'd have to go to design. We'd have to go.
Exactly.
So the earliest of in terms of either retrofit or new, the earliest that we could start the work is probably 2017.
Yeah.
Right?
Exactly.
By the time you do your planning. And you know what? You should do your planning. You should be slow on your planning.
Yeah.
Because you can engage the community in that process. You can come up with a couple of options and go to the community. Like, so the downside, of course, to that is from a political perspective, it then creates an election. It makes it an election issue,
mm-hmm.
right? Which, you know, is it an election issue? I don't know. Like, maybe it should be, maybe it isn't. I don't know. But it does. But by doing the timing, it certainly will create a discussion on the issue at a time where you might actually be, you know, running for another term of office.
Well, I understood
mm-hmm.
it.
Go ahead.
I understood it to be a practical issue, not a political issue. So I'm saying, why make it a political issue? Because it will certainly become one. And it's to the advantage of the, like I said in the first opening statement, it's to the advantage of people running against sentence councils. You can argue that day and night, but
yeah.
that's the situation, and I know that's what it is.
Mm-hmm.
And people can argue it, but I will not listen to them, because it's just, that's just the way it is. And something controversial, which it will be for some people, no matter
yes.
how you spell it out to people, it'll still be controversial to a lot of people, and that will become an issue.
And what you said, Councillor Donaldson, is right. It's going to become a political issue at some point anyway. And I think that if we were going to do some consultation with good information, it's best to have that out there prior to the election.
No, I think
the information
next November is when this should be being discussed and starting planning and going to public meetings. Everything's over with and done with, and it's 4 years to sort it out and get it done
yeah,
and
but,
built.
But what I'm afraid of in that case is the word is out there that we're talking about a building, and if we don't do anything, I think it becomes a political issue whereby people are saying, oh, they don't want to talk about, they don't want to do anything before the election. So something is brewing there that it's almost as if we're hiding something to me. That's just my view.
We would be.
You know, because if we plan on doing this and we say, well, we're not going to do it right now, to me it becomes a political issue at that point whereby they're saying, oh, they just don't want to do this prior to the election. And that could be as detrimental to politically as if we were doing something. That's why I think the more information they have, maybe it won't be as much of a political issue if we can come up with the proper reasons why this is going to be happening. They'll know.
Oh,
because right now they don't know.
In theory, what you're saying is right. How it's going to wash out isn't right. That don't work that way.
Yeah. You could be right. I don't know, but...
Yeah.
The answer now to anybody asking is we're looking at options of whether we should be building or if we should be renovating and adding on to this one. And there's a lot of questions to be answered, and you can string that along for a few months. And
okay.
by then you're... Anyhow, that's...
Yeah.
Okay.
I told you I wasn't going to change.
All right. Councillor Surratt again.
I'd like to table this till the next meeting, till our next meeting, or when the CEO can get that information on the building codes and that. I'd like to table that. I'd like to make a motion on that.
Second. So it's been moved and seconded to table it to the next meeting before until we get the information from the CEO. Is that CAO, sorry? Is that how I okay?
So the next meeting, just for the public's point of view, is November 10th.
Okay.
Yes.
So will that give you enough time to get that,
do you want more time?
Information?
In terms of interpreting the building code, that should be plenty of time.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
In terms of the impact,
yeah.
we'll see.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. Yeah.
So no more discussion. You all heard the motion. All those in favor, signify saying aye.
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. Okay. We'll move on to 4B, which is private roads. I think we do have an attachment here, if I can find it. I think this has to do with the Montague Road. Is that correct, C.A. Muse?
Yes, sir. So this is, and Chris can correct me if I'm wrong, this is the same request for decision that was presented 2 months ago. Do you want me to retrofit that chair, or do you want me to buy you a new?
You know the answer.
So there's no change in the. Sorry, I couldn't resist.
Yeah.
By the way, you know what? I want to tell you something. We're very lucky to be able to have this conversation in the way that we had it. I just want to say that out loud.
Yeah.
I'm very grateful for the opportunity to have a conversation on a controversial topic in a way that you've done right here and now. I mean, you're not always going to agree on everything. That's understood. You're going to have to make hard decisions. That's understood. But the way that you go about it, I hear that every day when I go out into other places. I hear how effective that you are in terms of decision making. I just think that you guys get hammered all the time for the decisions you were not supposed to make and all that stuff. I just want to say it out loud that I'm grateful for the opportunity to have a conversation with all of you in a professional way.
Yes.
It doesn't happen everywhere, and I want to thank you for that.
Right. Thank you.
So, private road ownership is this is a recycle request for decision. We had tabled it because we didn't have all the information. We have yet to speak with the owner of the road, so I don't really know what to do with this. We can table it again, or we can make a decision.
I don't know what to do.
So that's up to you, Mr. and Mrs. Councilors.
Okay, I guess Councilor Donaldson, you have your light on first.
What have we been now? 25 months, based on here. It doesn't. I mean, we're focusing on a road. Mm-hmm. I think we should be focusing on all the private roads we have and the impact. If we try to pull a favor for one road, what's the impact going to be long term? Because there's lots of private roads that we'd certainly like to have maintenance services and snow clearing and whatnot. And my road would be considered one of those, being a half a kilometer long. So we've got to have a policy that addresses everything, not pick and choose. That's what I feel. And I think it's in here, one of the recommendations, but.
So the suggestion options, just to help you out, Councillor, is yes, council will consider ownership of private roads, or no, council's position is not to take over private roads. Either decision requires an amendment to either your land use bylaw, your municipal planning strategy and land use bylaw.
I mean, there's some responsibility on people when and where they decide to build. Those are issues that should be looked at before you build your house. I mean, I chose to build a half a mile long road to have my house. Some people may not choose. Anyhow, enough said.
Okay, Councillor Bourque.
Yeah, I just wanted to mention, we've been trying to contact Gordon Amuro from Amuro and Surrett, and I would just like for him to contact the municipality to discuss whether the road has been stamped that it is a, an engineered road.
Mm-hmm.
And just to find out if that's what it is. If not, well, I think we have almost our decision made from there on. So I'd just like for him to speak to our staff first, and then we could make a decision.
All right, Councillor Surratt.
I think we're opening, like Councillor Donaldson opened up a can of worms. I know I've got two places in my district that would be coming knocking on the door. And I think once and for all, we should make a decision on, you know, go to the our planning advisory committee and, you know, make a decision on, you know, what our legal bounds are, what our decision should be on the roads we don't own. There should be something in our bylaws that says that we don't take over these roads, point blank. That's my opinion.
Okay, Councilor Donaldson.
If we go with the council's position on the no, this has been going on for 25 months. I think we've done all we can possibly do to try to get the information. The onus is going to be put on the person that constructed the road, the residents that live on this road that want change. We've tried and done all we could to get information, and it's not coming. So somehow the onus is going to be put on them to prove to us that's engineered. And I don't know what else to say. It's just, I mean, we can ask, they can ask. I mean, we're just not getting nowhere. It's just going back and forth. I would assume if there was engineered reports, they would be there, and they would have been forward a long time ago or brought forward. I just don't think there's information there. I think it was just built the way things were built back then. But there you go.
All right. So we've heard a few comments around the table.
I'd like to make a motion.
Go ahead.
That staff ensure that the wording in the municipal planning strategy is clear on our position to not take over private roads. So that's my motion.
Seconded by Richard. Okay. Any more comments? We've heard the motion. So all those in favor, signify saying aye.
Aye.
Contrary?
Nay.
Nay. And you want that recorded?
Yes.
Okay. Is that the only nay? Do believe that. Okay. Thank you. All right. Move to number five, financial report. Is that for Marcia? Go ahead.
Yep. All right. So enclosed is the financial report as at and up until September 30th of 2015, it being halfway point for the 2015-16 fiscal year, showing an estimated surplus of $160,811. To highlight some of the bigger variances of surplus and over expenditures, the main surplus in the revenues is the deed transfer tax, showing a surplus of $15,439. In the transfers, the due from operating reserves, we've reduced the transfers from the operating reserve by $30,000, as that amount was to be used for the family residency grant to the Southwest Health. When we look in the expenditures, in the expenses, general admin is showing a surplus, which is a combination of a few small amounts. Some of these is an issue of timeliness, and some of it is staff trying to save costs as well. If we look on page 9, other government general services, about halfway down the page, capital renovations is showing at an over expenditure of $22,551. That is the combination of the generator leak and the leaking roof damage to the building. Both of these items were obviously unforeseen during budgeting time. Under property inspection, there are some savings there, mainly due to the timing of the hiring of the new facility maintenance coordinator. And we've also budgeted maintenance of sidewalks and roads, which is mostly snow removal for both of these. On page 11, under the West Palmetto Coast Sewer, the bulk of this over expenditure is the wastewater support. Our wastewater operator was longer than anticipated. Therefore, the support was kept on for longer than budgeted. Under garbage and collection disposal, we are showing a savings. Some of this line items are only estimated. therefore could change. However, disposal fees tend to sometimes be difficult to budget as it fluctuates from year to year. In the healthcare, the major savings is the other side of the family residence that we have brought in, no longer needing the revenue, because that will not be expended, will not occur in this fiscal year. The recreation has a surplus, which is a combination of some small amounts. Part of it is due to the fact that some of the programs have not yet occurred. However, also the recreation staff has been able to find funding for some of their programs after the budget was set to offset some of these expenses. And the courthouse has a surplus, which is mostly the capital equipment. They have budgeted for a new microfiche reader scanner, which has not yet been purchased. So that is the bulk of the larger items. And if there's any questions.
Great. Good. Good.
Another 6 months.
All right. Any questions?
Nope. We're right on.
Good.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks. Second.
Okay, moved and seconded to accept the report. All those in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. Okay, we'll move to number six. Other business for decision and discussion. 6A, Mariner Center Feasibility Study and Heat Recovery Project. Find that one.
So there's two attachments there.
Yep. Yep.
This is a follow-up from the presentation from Mr. Dares. I'll be brief, I think. So there's the feasibility study, which as you recall, was a conversation around, let's see what an expansion of the Mariner Center might look like. In particular, it was the aquatic center and the curling rink that they were looking at determining you know, what the cost would be for that expansion, both and I'm assuming both capital and operating. I know that it is a feasibility study on the capital. That particular cost is going to be $75,000. Phase one is $25,000, and Mr. Dares from on behalf of the Mariner Center was requesting for financial support for that study. By supporting the, and so the recommendation here is to approve support of up to a maximum of $5,000. So clearly we you know, whatever decision you make around that number, we're suggesting that it would be a maximum of $5,000 if you choose to invest in that particular initiative. This does not bind you to the actual project. I mean, I think it's this is an information gathering exercise. Right? So the second is the heat recovery project, and the heat recovery project. I think I've told the story more than once. You know, this one is about there's two components to the heat recovery project. The heat recovery project was initially this big at about $500,000, and then what they realized was there was another component that they could take care of that would be better to do it now. So it added another $200,000 to the initial project. So what we know is the original project was committed, the funding was committed by both the town and municipality of Yarmouth. And the commitment of that project predates any sort of fiscal commitment that we made to the Mariner Center. So how this is presented to you makes the assumption that it's about the incremental cost, not the total cost. Okay, so it's about the additional cost. And so what we're saying is the additional cost is $169,000. And what we're saying is we clearly benefit from this capital project. The result will be that the oil costs of operation for the Mariner Center will reduce drastically as a consequence of this. So if we want our cookies hot, we probably should pay a little bit for the oven. Is really the concept that we're presenting here, right? Because we will be getting a benefit from this, right? It's not just lost, and so that's why we are presenting. Actually, we're presenting we're recommending a favorable reaction because we will recover this cost over time. If we don't support it, the project will probably occur anyway. All right, like politically. From a political perspective, they'll probably move ahead because it's the right thing to do. So the question in front of you is whether or not you feel a responsibility to participate in that. And keep in mind that the participation from the town and the municipality is, you know, we would be suggesting, you know, a $40,000 to $60,000 investment on a $654,000 project. So we're clearly not a third on this project, nor do we have to be in accordance with the agreements.
That's right.
So what we're, and the reason why we're suggesting an investment is for the reasons that I've suggested, but there's a second reason, and it's what we can use to pay for it. And it's, we can use our federal gas tax to pay for this. So we're using federal gas taxes. So this kind of sounds a little bit like the wind turbine, but not quite. You can use federal gas tax to invest in this particular project, and the result will be a reduced operating costs for you. So with the wind turbine example, it's you use your federal gas tax and you make money with that. That's better. But in this particular case, that's what we're presenting. So there's two decisions to be made.
All right.
Or not made on yep. the Mariner side.
Councillor Donaldson.
Yeah. I don't know who else has been to the what's it called in New Glasgow, Stellarton, the Wellness Center.
Yeah.
I have been there. It's an awesome facility. They've done it right. There's a lot of argument because it was five or six councils that had to come together on it, but they finally got it done. And to me, if there is a regional asset that benefits, well, more than three municipalities, it benefits Clare and Burlington too, but they're not part of the agreement. This is one of them, and I'm in favor of supporting both of these projects. And I'll make a motion on the first one is to, we'll give our share of what's $5,000 or
up to
$5,000 for the study.
Okay, so move to approve financial support of up to a maximum of $5,000 for phase one of the feasibility study of the Mariner Center's needs. Is that correct?
That's correct, and I would add that that is an unbudgeted item, and I expect a surplus in our capital reserve because I anticipated certain expenses that I know will not occur this year. So I would suggest that this would come out of the capital reserve.
Okay.
And as it's eligible. It's an eligible expense in the capital reserve.
I agree right. with that.
Okay. That's been moved and seconded. All those in favor?
I've had a question.
Oh, sorry. Councilor, go ahead.
Quite one question there before we voted, yeah. Yes, and you've answered my one of the questions was not budgeted for. If I remember right, there was a portion here from a COLA in the province that could be coming for this project for the $25,000. So I would suggest that why don't we wait? And the reason, I guess, a COA didn't come on board, if I remember right from Gildares, was because it was the election time and that. So I would suggest, why don't we wait if they can get the money from a COA and try to get to pay for this whole item? Because he thought that there would be money, there could be money coming from them. And the province. So my thing was, I'm not convinced really that, you know, we should vote on this right at the moment, because, you know, if there's money that they can apply for, why not try to get some money that'll pay and maybe lessen our share, or maybe we won't need to share at all.
I can answer some of that.
Yes.
So first of all, the cost of the study is $75,000, not $25,000. What he's trying to do is he's trying not to lose momentum. That was one of the logic for trying to move on it faster. Regardless of what he does, he's going to require municipal funds because the ECOA and provincial funding will not fully fund the feasibility.
But he could lessen our portion.
Well, I mean, I'm quite confident that he's going to secure funding on the $25,000 from the province. I can't confirm that.
Yeah.
What he's trying to secure is a COA funding on the remainder.
Yeah. Okay.
And so usually what happens in those situations when you're doing a phased approach is that a COA will look backwards on this. So the fact that you're making this motion now doesn't force them to move immediately on the feasibility study. Yeah. It does commit you to an amount.
Yeah.
And so the downside of waiting is that they don't get the ECOA funding, and the request is higher.
Yeah.
Right. So if you make your commitment now, it might actually, sometimes it's chicken and egg, right?
Right.
Where you have to make a commitment in order to get ECOA funding.
Yeah.
So I think they need a commitment one way or another, and I don't think it's too early to make that decision.
Okay.
And the amount isn't unreasonable. Like if it was you know much higher, I would be a little bit more cautious.
Yeah.
This might actually finish the request and they'll move forward with other funds that are not ours.
Thank you for that clarification.
Okay.
Yeah.
You all right with that?
Thank you.
So we have a motion on the floor. All those in favor, signify saying aye.
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 Contrary? Carried. So that's the first one. And then there's the other one. That's the
So this is the capital and the heat recovery.
Capital and heat recovery. So, Councilor Surratt?
Would this be money coming from this year on that second request from our budget? Would that money be coming, like, this is not budgeted money, right?
That's correct.
This
the answer to your question is maybe. Unlikely.
Under the gas, but it's gas tax. It's still
it is. If it's used this year, it is not budgeted gas tax money.
Yes.
However, we budgeted gas tax money to happen that will not occur this year. So. You know, whether it lands in this year or next year, we're probably good either way. The money is certainly there.
Right. I would like to make the motion that we move forward on this request.
Second.
Okay.
So just for clarity, the request is It offers a range.
For the 169,000, our third of the portion of that.
Right, so that was...
So
it says move, the suggested motion, is that what you're looking for?
Sorry, thank you. Move to request a formal letter from the Mariner Center requesting funding for the project and approve funding between 40 and 60,000 based on the presented calculations and representing 33.3% of the incremental cost of the project. Man, you're good on that.
So the only thing is the suggested motion shows a range. What we want is an amount. So if you want to the calculated amount is 56,000. If you want to do that, then put that in the motion.
I would move the 66,000 is what I would like to move.
56?
Thank you, Allah.
All right. Yeah. No, just because I didn't know where you wanted to invest, that's why we put a range
the
in
the
motion.
The way to do it.
Oh, okay.
I should have moved that there.
Yeah.
Okay, so 56,000. Okay. Any questions? We have a motion on the floor. All those in favor, signify saying aye.
Aye.
Contrary? Carried. All right. Move on to 6B, approval of RFP active transportation. I think we have an attachment.
You haven't seen the RFP, you've been presented with our approach. I'm not gonna read verbatim what it says here. There is an executive summary that was done by Natalie. I think what's important for you to know is we're going out to price, which is in the budget, by the way, an active transportation plan to be done by a third party. We're hoping and are confident for provincial funds, and the scope of the work will be to increase. So we want to attain the following goals: to increase walking, running, biking, and kayaking in the municipality, to create transportal loops where people can get to infrastructure, whether it is for work, business, or play, to identify existing areas that need to be upgraded to increase active transportation, active transportation opportunities in areas such as schools and business hubs in the municipality, identify links to the provincial Blue Route Initiative, which for some of you have seen at the UNSM, which is they're trying to do a blue route, which is a cycling route. And so we shouldn't be isolated in our conversations around how we deal with active transportation. The province is dealing with active transportation. Let's link with them. And finally, to provide the municipality, the district, a 15 to 20 year active transportation plan. So this is about active transportation for play or work. This isn't, so this is, you know, why we're doing this is to create these loops where people can actually get from to fro, right? And so this may result in infrastructure improvements. It may result in recommendations that say you need a route to be extended to go to a school to be safe, or to enable people to go from a school to an alternate route, for example. Like, I'm thinking right off the top of my head, École Paramba. You know, how could students get from Paramba to our trail, for example, right? So that's just, I'm not saying that's what's going to happen, I'm just saying that's an example of something that could be looked at. And so we'll hire experts in this field. We're looking for people with rural active transportation experience, not urban, because we're not urban, right? We are fingers, and it's a challenge for us to be actively to have active transportation to work in Argyle. It's challenging. So, you know, we understand that. So we're very targeted in the way we're going to approach this. And we're not forgetting the water, right? Because the water offers opportunities too. So this is the RFP. It was done in conjunction with the province of Nova Scotia. They've looked at it multiple times. Natalie, I think, has done a very good job preparing it. I've been involved in the process. There's a subcommittee that has looked at this and that has approved what you're looking at. And I would recommend that you pass a motion to release this RFP. And obviously the results of that will come to you for information if it's within budget, for approval if it is not.
I'll so move that we approve the RFP.
Okay, it's been moved by Warden Dottrell, seconded by Councillor Book. Any questions? Okay, you've heard the motion. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Contrary? Carried. Thank you. Okay, number 7, correspondence, and for information, we have waste check minutes of October 19th. I do believe that myself and Councillor Surrett were there.
Yeah.
I think we talked a lot about the, I'm just going to make sure I get the letters right, EPR, yeah, extended producer's responsibility. I think you took in the meeting in Truro, and you wrote a report. I think everybody got the report. It was a very, very good report. You have anything else to add on that? Or?
Maybe for just maybe the public out there that, you know, the plan is what the government has, is to go to a full, it's called EPR, it's extended producer responsibility. And small example, which I think I had said here one time, was they say you buy a bag of chips, that chip has to go in the garbage, in the garbage bag, it costs money to get rid of that. So what they want to do is maybe get the company to pay 1/100th of a cent on that chip bag to get it from when it was produced to by the time it ends in the landfill. And whatever it's going to cost, they want it put in the price. It's going to be put in the price of that bag when we buy it. So we don't see any increases in that price of the chip. Actually, for the chip bag, it's already in there across Canada. Believe it or not, Frito-Lay and Humpty Dumpty and those people have that cost all across, and we're actually paying for it now. Some of the provinces that are benefiting out of that would be Alberta, New Brunswick, and BC. So it's in there, so it's no added cost to the people, to the residents. And anyhow, there was a lot of discussion on where this was going, the pros and cons, and it's supposed to be cost neutral. It's not going to cost any of our ratepayers any more money. We may have a few little things to negotiate with the haulers, possibly, they're not sure. But anyhow, it was a good meeting, and I think it's a good way moving forward.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for your report. Anybody else have any questions on those minutes? If not, we'll move on to financial requests, which we have none. Number 9, notice of motion. Anybody have a notice of motion? Nope. Yeah. Oh, sorry. I didn't see that. Go ahead.
I'd like to make a notice of motion for a future meeting on the Hipson Bridge in East Pomniko.
Hipson Bridge.
I would like for it to be revisited for the structure. This bridge here, there's only two of its kind in its form, that original form in Canada. So I'm wondering if we could be maybe eligible for the Canada 150th anniversary funding, because it's a site also as known as where the first Acadians landed. So it has a history there. So that's my motion.
Okay. So we'll be bringing that to the next meeting. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay, number 10, question period. Any questions? Nope. Number 11, adjournment. Anybody care to adjourn?
Second.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
All right, okay.